Ms. Triop say more about that later at the conclusion of our service. Dr. David Ball is our leader in this. David became my friend in 1973 when he and Pat came to our house in Biloxi and stayed with us until past 2 o'clock in the morning, telling us the reasons why we needed to be pastoring in Batesville. As a result of that time together and my subsequent 7.5 years as his pastor, I've come to know him as one of the most genuine men that I've ever known. So when he asked me to serve as vice chairman of his board of trustees when we officially organized this ministry a couple of years ago, I was honored to do so. I am delighted to present to you this morning Dr. David Ball, my longtime friend and the chairman and the spokesperson of the Cross Ministry. David.
Behold the Lamb. Behold. Board of Directors of the Cross Ministry is pleased to present a multimedia production of the crucifixion and death of a man called Jesus. This will be narrated by Dr. David Ball. In the next hour, you'll see a graphic presentation of the pain and agony of the crucifixion of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Because of our familiarity with the subject matter, we are sometimes complacent in our acceptance of the free gift of salvation. But in a sense, as Dietrich Bonhoeffer says, our salvation is not free. It is costly because it costs Jesus everything. And we sometimes say in an almost trite manner, He died so that we might live. It is the prayer of the Cross Ministry that after seeing this presentation, you will never be the same again.
In the beginning was the Word.
The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us.
His own received him not. He was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. The Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth.
Who would have ever thought the creator of this universe, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, would choose to come to earth to live among us in the flesh? But the Lord works in mysterious ways, and so in our own lives, we live by dying, we lead by serving, and we receive by giving. And everything we do as Christian people, we wait upon the Lord at His time. In 1969, I was serving in Vietnam as a flight surgeon in the United States Air Force. I had excess free time on my hands, limited access to good reading material. And so I came across a book by a French physician entitled A Doctorate Calvary. This book detailed the gory events of the crucifixion. I read it. I found it quite unappealing and put it down out of sight and out of mind, or so I thought. Almost 20 years later, in 1988, an article appeared in the Journal of the American Medical Association, again detailing the events of the crucifixion of Jesus. It was the conclusion of these authors that Jesus died of suffocation. Well, by that time, I had developed a little interest in the topic and had done some reading and research of my own. And I had come to the very firm conclusion that Jesus did not die of suffocation. And so firm were my convictions about this matter till I wrote an article myself in rebuttal that appeared in the Mississippi State Medical Journal. This was entitled The Crucifixion and Death of a Man Called Jesus. And subsequent to that, I began to receive invitations to speak in various churches around the area. That's a brief historical testimony. I am here today to present the cross of Jesus Christ, the cross and nothing more. God has given me this ministry. He didn't give me this ministry because I'm a doctor. Rather, He chose to make me a doctor a long time ago, so that I would be prepared for the ministry to which He has called me. Today, perhaps more than ever in our nation's history, we need the cross. You and I want a pound of flesh. And to some extent, we are entitled. On an individual basis, we need not justice, but we need mercy. Mercy that only comes through the cross
of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Common criminals on a forlorn hillside overlooking the ancient city of Jerusalem, the saga of an itinerant Jewish preacher comes to an ignominious end. The only victory party being celebrated at that time was being celebrated in hell. Satan had finally done it. He had brought the King of Kings to his heels. He had bruised the heel of the seed of woman.
There were no victory celebrations that day on Golgotha's Hill. There were no bands playing. There were no shouts of victory. All of that was taking place in hell, where Satan and all of his demons were having a match. But Satan is not omniscient. He is, in fact, quite myopic and sees only the immediate. And so while Satan and all of his demons were reveling in the victory of the battle, they failed to notice they had lost the war. The victory is in the resurrection. That is a victory so stunning that this world is still celebrating almost 2,000 years later. Celebrating because each and every time one of us brings our sins to the foot of the cross, the resurrection is reenacted. That is God's wonderful, gracious, loving, and merciful plan to save sinners like you and me. Because all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And God knows the wages of that sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And all we have to do is confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. And believe in our hearts that God has raised him from the dead. And we will be saved. And for me, that is best summed up in Galatians 2:20, where it says, I am crucified with Christ, and nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. And that is God's wonderful, gracious, loving, and merciful plan to save sinners like you and like me. And so Jesus came to this earth with a purpose. The purpose was to substitute for you and for me.
As human beings are born so that we can live. That is clearly the purpose of the process of birth. To the Christian, however, there is something inherently antithetical in this idea. We recognize that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the author of life, was born so that he could die. And while we cling to life, Jesus chose the cross. That choice culminated in the garden called Gethsemane.
Didn't come to show us what God could do draped in the garb of human flesh. Instead, Jesus came to show us what humble carpenter could do when he is totally submitted to the will of the Father in heaven. In that respect, he fought no greater battle than in Gethsemane, where he literally sweated drops of blood as he anguished over the choice that he knew he had to make. That is why the man, Jesus, prayed, Father, if there is some other way that my mission here on earth can be accomplished. And then in one short, simple, and insightful sentence, Jesus said, "Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done." There is no greater summation of Christian discipleship than that. "Nevertheless, not my will, but the Father's be done." And so, Jesus was betrayed by Judas for 30 pieces of silver, the redemption price of a slave. And he was taken off by the Roman army as the trial of the ages began. This trial was illegal and it was inhumane. It was illegal because it took place at night. And according to Jewish law, you could not try a man after sunset. But even if you would argue that the official trial of Jesus took place after sunup, before Pilate, it was still illegal. It was illegal because according to Jewish law, you could not try and convict a man and then execute him on the same day. You had to wait 24 hours before the execution could take place. But the primary reason that this trial was illegal was that the verdict was determined before the trial took place. You see, the Jewish priest felt threatened by this man, Jesus. There was something about the way he spoke. There was authority in his voice. His teachings had a ring of truth. Crowds were gathering. The people were listening to what he said. The priest knew they had to do something. They did. They bought witnesses and had a key.
Before they killed him, they stripped him of his clothes and tied him to a whipping post.
Tied to this whipping post, the Roman lictors began the punishment. They brought the whip down. They brought the bare back of Jesus because he was killed in his place. You and I think that that's something like what took place that night. In truth, it's nothing at all like what took place. Instead, they took a Roman cat of nine tails. This was a whip with multiple leather strips, tied into which were pieces of bone, and glass, and lead, and rock, and anything that would tear into the flesh. And they began the beating like that as they brought that whip across the back of the victim. And it began to tear into the flesh. And they continued until he was profusely bleeding, and there was nothing left on his back but ribbons of flesh and exposed ribs. Because you see, they could literally beat a man to death with this whip. It was used as a means of capital punishment. And so now, the next time you see or read Isaiah 53:5, I want you to remember, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with those stripes, you and I are healed. This is a typical artist rendition of Jesus Christ, our Lord, taking his cross out to Golgotha's hill. There's something dreadfully wrong with this. I want you to think for a moment about what you've just seen. They stripped Jesus of his clothes and they nearly beat him to death with that Roman cat of nine tails. Then they put a 100-pound cross piece on his back. This looks like Jesus is wearing a nice, freshly dry cleaned robe as he's carrying his cross out to Calvary. In truth, Jesus was nearly beaten to death when they put the cross piece on his back. The King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the creator of this universe, could hardly take his own cross to Golgotha's hill. Jesus Christ, the creator, who at the sound of his voice could still the waters or annihilate the whole Roman army, chose instead the frailties of human flesh so that he could demonstrate his love for you and for me. And so they force marched him on out to Golgotha's hill. There are three primary characters that I want us to look at in this scene. The first, of course, is Jesus, who is taking his cross out to Calvary, stumbling and falling along the way. And so they conscripted a man, Simon of Cyrene, to carry the cross piece for Jesus. Simon is a very important character. Looks like he's just almost of no significance as he appears on the pages of the Bible and then disappears. But he's very important. We'll come back to him later. Then there was the third group, the Jewish priests. The Jewish priests were the preachers. They represented the religious people of the day. The Sunday school teachers, the deacons, the regular churchgoers. They were the ones who were crucifying Jesus. But you see, in the background, there was another scene going on. The Jewish priests had to be back at the temple grounds because today was the day of preparation for the Passover. This was the day that the Jewish priests were supposed to be sacrificing the lambs for the Passover. And this man, Jesus, was stumbling and falling. And it looked like he wasn't going to make it to Golgotha's hill. And so they conscripted Simon to carry the cross so they could get on out there and get back to the church to do their thing. I don't want you to miss this. This is critical. The priests were so busy playing church till they failed to notice the King of Kings standing in their very presence. Have you ever been there? I have. I've been so busy sometimes playing church till I fail to spend time with the King of Kings. Don't do that. Especially don't do that to your pastor. He needs time to spend with the King of Kings if he's going to do justice when he stands on this mountain. So they took Jesus on out to Golgotha's hill to be crucified.
History is written one moment at a time, but one moment of time defines all of history. And history is defined by the cross. The moment that Jesus died, history was changed from eternity past to eternity future. Nothing was ever or will ever be the same. The value of every event in history is now determined by examining it from the blood-drenched cross of Calvary. It is our intent now to take you as close to the cross as is humanly possible. We pray that the Holy Spirit will do the rest.
The crucifixion is a thoroughly heinous means of torture. It is so cruel that the Jews never used it. The Romans, who became masters at the art of crucifixion, never used it on their own citizens. Instead, they used it against political dissidents to bring them into subjection. There were several options that were used when a victim was crucified. The Romans had become such masters at it that they could literally determine how long an individual would last on a cross. The first option was whether or not to use nails to hang the victim on the cross. They didn't have to. You could tie an individual to a cross and walk off and leave him, and he would die sooner or later of thirst and starvation and the wild animals picking away his flesh. But if they were in a hurry, and we know they were, with Jesus, then they would use nails. They would place these nails not in the palms of the hands, as most of us think and most modern pictures depict. Because if they placed the nail in the palm of the hand, then when the individual slumped and supported his weight from the nails, they would simply tear through the palm. Instead, they would place them in the wrist. Now, some of you may be purists, and you insist that the Bible says hands, but the Greek word for hand includes the wrist, as does Gray's Anatomy today. If you look under the bones of the hands, you will find those of the wrist located there also. Now, what was real important here was this positioning of the nail. They would place it right in that little spot called the space of destone, bounded by these carpal bones. That way, the individual, when he slumped, he would not pull the nails through. But there was a more sadistic reason that the Romans placed the nail in the space of destone. Because traveling just above the space of destone, there's the median nerve. And then, when the individual slumps on the cross, the median nerve is impinged upon that nail, and bolts of lightning go out of the hands as they burn with pain and agony. The Romans knew what they were doing. But if the placement of the nails in the hands was critical, then I would have to tell you that the placement of the nails in the feet was absolutely important and critical. What they would do is take a nail like this. The first option was that they would have the feet turned sideways and they could place the nail through the heels into the upright. Now, in this manner, as you can see, the individual, while he may not be completely comfortable, he can lock his knees in place. Ronnie, you're going to help. He can lock his knees in place. This way he can stay there for quite some time. Now, if instead they were in a hurry, as we know they were with Jesus, they would place the sole of the foot flat against the upright. They would take this nail then and drive it through the front of the foot into the cross. This is an entirely different situation. Because this way, the individual cannot lock his knees. He has to support himself with the muscles in his thighs. And when he gets tired, then he lets himself down so that he can rest. Now, Jeff, you comfortable? What's wrong? Feels like these sockets are being pulled out of place. Now, Psalms 22 says, all my bones are out of joint. You need to read that. It was written by the Jews. It is prophetic of a crucifixion, even though the Jews never used crucifixion. Feels like your sockets and bones are being pulled out of joint. And so when you hurt bad enough, and remember the median nerve as it travels out into the hand here, bolts of lightning going out into these hands. Then he pushes himself up to relieve the pressure. And then he has to support himself with his muscles and the legs of his thumb. The longest that I've ever had anyone to hang on that cross, 15 minutes. At the end of 15 minutes, that individual was wringing wet with sweat, begging me to let him down. He was a former pastor, so I wouldn't let him down. He ran 5 miles a day, as a matter of fact. Gets to hurt his death. Thank you, Jeff. Pain and agony of the crucifixion is almost indescribable. The unmerited suffering of Jesus as he hung on that cross tells of his unlimited love for you and for me. And as Jesus hung on that cross and his life flickered as a spent wick on a candle, a darkness came over the earth matched only by the primordial darkness that pervaded the universe before God spoke light into existence. And as his light finally flickered out, the heavens bellowed their thunderous response to the agony of Jesus on the cross.
It is finished.
The question that still haunts the world today is, what was it that was really finished that day on Golgotha's hill? And I hope before we finish today, you will understand exactly and precisely what it was that was finished.
The agony of the crucifixion helps us to appreciate, but the physiology of those terminal hours in the life of Jesus helps us to understand. And it is this understanding which allows us to draw conclusions as to the cause of the death of Jesus.
If Jesus came for the purpose of dying, as I said he did, then I think it behooves us to try to understand something of the terminal hours of the life of this man Jesus. In order to do that, I want us to look at a typical crucifixion. Then I will try to explain to you what was different about the crucifixion of Jesus. In a typical crucifixion, the lungs remain partially inflated as the hands are over the head. The individual cannot exhale all the old, dead, stale air in his lungs. And so his respirations are limited. In order to breathe efficiently, he has to push himself up on the cross. That requires a significant increase in energy expenditure just to breathe on the cross. That usually in ordinary life is taken care of by a compensatory mechanism, and we breathe faster as we get short of breath. Our heart pumps faster. That is impossible by design on the cross. The Romans, again, knew what they were doing. The result of all of this is that the individual usually dies of suffocation. I'll explain to you how this usually happens. The first thing is that the individual becomes hypoxic. Don't panic. That just means that there is not enough oxygen in the individual's blood. And when that happens, then the body begins to do something kind of unusual. It begins something called anaerobic metabolism. Now what that means is, again, don't panic, it just means that the body begins to burn fuel without oxygen in order to keep it alive. God's planned this out. And so in that process, a lot of acid byproducts are built up. Now, most of you know what's going on there without realizing the terms. When you get out and run around the block and you're not in good shape, you begin to develop shin splints. You develop a cramp in your side. That's simply because your body is not getting enough oxygen for this exercise, and it's gone into anaerobic metabolism and builds up acid. Now, the next thing with those acid buildup, with that acid buildup, is that you develop muscle cramps while you're on the cross if you're not already in enough anguish. In order to take care of this, the heart begins to beat fast. So it is pumping furiously, trying to get every little drop of oxygen it can out of the lungs to carry it to vital organs. But then in the final analysis, in the very final analysis, in a last-ditch effort to maintain life, the body begins to shunt blood away from organs that it determines are not absolutely essential for life. And so it takes blood away from the leg muscles and carries it instead to the brain, to the heart, to the lungs, to the kidneys and liver, organs that it predetermines are essential to life. The problem on the cross is that those leg muscles are essential to lift one up to breathe. And so there is more trouble. You're already cramping. The pain is shooting out of your arms from the median nerves. You've got this acidosis developing. Your heart's beating furiously. And you don't have enough energy to lift yourself on the cross. And so usually, death occurs by suffocation on the cross. What I want to tell you is, Jesus did not die of suffocation. Absolutely, positively, he did not die of suffocation. Does it make any difference? It certainly does. And I'll try to explain it to you as we go.
The death of Jesus is foundational to Christianity. Without it, our sins are not atoned. Without it, the resurrection is not a reality. But how can we know?
How can we know? And is it important that we know? I've already answered. I told you, yes, it is very important. Let me explain just a little bit here to you so that you will understand. We'll just briefly take a little synoptic course in Theology 101, and let me explain something about some Christian principles here. Now, the virgin birth, the atoning death of Jesus on the cross is absolutely central to our faith. It is critical. Without the atoning death, we don't need to be here. We can go fishing, we can do whatever we want. There is no need for us to be here. But the atoning death has no significance if there was not a virgin birth. If Jesus Christ was not born out from under the curse of Adam. if he had not been born without imputed sin, then he could not be the perfect sacrificial lamb to die on that cross for us. And if he had not lived the sinless life, he could not have been the perfect Passover lamb to die in our place. Those are absolutely essential to our faith. But the atoning death, if it did not occur, if Jesus did not, in fact, die as he said he did, then I can tell you, there won't be a resurrection. If Jesus didn't die, there cannot possibly be a resurrection. And if Jesus didn't rise again on the third day, I'm here to tell you, you don't need to wait around for the return. If he didn't make it the first time, he won't be here the second time. And those are not just the rants of David Ball. 1 Corinthians 15:14 tells us, and if Christ be not risen, then our preaching is vain, and your faith is also vain. The atoning death of Jesus is central, the foundation to our faith. We must be able to demonstrate that Jesus Christ died. And so how are we going to demonstrate that Jesus died? There's a principle that I want you to understand in the Christian faith, and that is this matter of a need to know. Without it, we wouldn't understand the faith. You see, there are a lot of things in life that I want to know. There are a lot of things in life that I don't understand. We've got a new gadget here. Y'all excuse me. There are a lot of things that I don't understand in life, and a lot of things that I want to know. But God has told me that a lot of those things I don't need to know, because they're none of my business. But the death of Jesus Christ is absolutely essential to our faith. I must know. And wherever I must know, God has given me the answers. If I need to know, God's not going to hide it from me. It's in the Scriptures. So, because the death of Jesus is so foundational to our faith, he has given us the absolute answer. And you remember, I told you that the prestigious Journal of the American Medical Association had an article in which the authors determined that Jesus died of suffocation. How can I, a small-town GP from rural Mississippi, ever convince you different? My unabashed answer is look at the Scripture. The Synoptic Gospels all tell us Jesus cried with a loud voice and suddenly gave up the ghost. All three, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, say the same thing. I'm here to tell you that anybody that has enough air in their lungs to holler out is not about to die of suffocation. I've never seen anybody die on the cross. But I have seen many die of suffocation. Old chronic loners who smoke 2 or 3 packs of cigarettes a day all their life finally succumb to suffocation. Their lungs just simply cannot bring in enough oxygen to sustain life, and they die. It is an agonizing way to go, but it is quite. Jesus did not die of suffocation. If he didn't die of suffocation, then how did he die? It is my contention that Jesus died of a ruptured heart. I'm not the first person in the world to ever suggest that Jesus died of a ruptured heart. But what has bothered me over the years is that no one had given us an adequate explanation of how Jesus' heart would rupture on that cross. For many who said that Jesus had the sins of the world on his shoulders, and therefore, that ruptured his heart. Now, while I could never argue with that, because no one else has ever had all the sins of the world on his back, I can tell you that there is no medical literature anywhere that suggests that emotional stress or strain has any potential for causing a ruptured heart. But theologically, I can tell you that won't work. Because if every one of you out there, if everyone in all of history had been born out from under the curse of Adam, without any imputed sin, and you had never sinned in your life, and David Ball was the only sinner in this world, guess what? My Jesus would have gone to the cross for me. And he would have had no more sins on his back than I have on my back. And my heart was broken. Now, there's another reason. And because it's so important, God gives us the answers to his holy word. The details are there. We just often don't spend enough time looking to find them. You remember I told you about Simon of Cyrene, conscripted to carry the cross piece for Jesus, because Jesus was stumbling and falling along the way. And then he fell with his cross piece on his back, weighing about 100 pounds. And mind you, he almost certainly was not carrying the whole cross. The vertical piece remained in place out on Golgotha's Hill, and they simply carried the cross piece. But this 100-pound cross piece would pin him against the cobblestone pavement of the Dolorosa, and he would sustain a significant contusive injury to the front part of his chest, which would in turn could result in a bruise to the heart, which in turn could result in a rupture of the heart with bleeding. Let me explain to you a little bit about how that works. The heart is encased in a pericardial sac. This is a diagrammatic drawing. But if the heart ruptures, every time it pumps, it squirts blood out into this enclosed pericardial sac around the heart. And it continues that until the pressure in that sac builds up. And the pressure in the sac equals the pressure that can be generated by the heart when it's pumping. And when that happens, the heart is choked down. It stops beating. That's called cardiac tamponade. It results in certain death. The individual dies quickly, but he has a sense of impending doom and a chance to holler out before he dies. Exactly what happened on the cross. Now, again, back to our need to know principle. I have formulated a nice little scenario here of what could have happened and what might have happened. It is important for us to know absolutely, positively certain, for certain, how that happened and if it happened. And because it is so important, God has given us the answer in his holy word. Something very unusual. God gave us a post-mortem exam of the body of Jesus. And it is recorded in John, the 19th chapter, beginning in verse 31 through 35. The Jews, therefore, because it was a Sabbath, that the body should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for that Sabbath was on high day, besought Pilate that their legs might be broken, that they might be taken away. Then came the soldiers and brake the legs of the first, and of the other who was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus, and saw that he was dead already, they brake not his leg. But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water. And he that saw it bare a record. And his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith true, that he might believe. There is just an incredible amount of detail in these verses. We could spend the next hour probably talking about it, but there are a couple of points that I want to make for you. The first of these is a matter of breaking the legs. This was the coup de grace. This was the thing that hastened the death. If the individual was not dying as quickly as they wanted him to, they would take a wooden club, and they would bring this club down across the shin bones of the individual and just literally bust him into smithereens. Individual would drop. He would not be able to push himself up. He would die rather quickly. The other point that I want us to understand is this matter of the sword. They took a sword. This is an exact replica of the standard issue sword of the Roman army at the time of the crucifixion of Jesus. This was the coup de grace to end all questions as to whether the individual was dead. Well, they came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, just to put it to rest, so that there would be no doubt. They took this sword and they ran it up through his side into his heart and give it a jiggle and they pull it out. He would die if he was not already. This was the coup de grace. They didn't have a Colt 45, but they were trained in this maneuver to put to rest the question of whether or not Jesus was dead. And so, God has given us all the answers that we need to know. And I want us to look at these. There are three possibilities in this scenario that I have drawn up for you. The first of these is that when they came to Jesus with the sword, if Jesus was alive when the Roman soldiers came and thrust the sword into his side, what would happen? If he was alive, he would bleed. He would bleed rather profusely for a very short period of time, and he would die. There would be no water. On the other hand, if Jesus was dead from some other cause, any other cause than a ruptured heart, what would happen? Dead men don't bleed. John knew that. He knew there was something unusual going on here. Third option. Jesus died with a ruptured heart, just like I said he did. What would happen? Let me show you again. They take this sword, they run it up through the side into this pericardial sac that was bulging under pressure, like a balloon filled with water. They run it up in there, jiggle it, bring it out. Out would come blood, which had settled to the bottom, followed by the clear fluid, the pericardial fluid, and the serum in the blood, which had gone to the top. Blood followed by water. Exactly what God's word says would happen. Now, just for a moment, I want us to go back to John's account. John tells us, he that saw it bore record. John knew that something very unusual was going on here. John knew that dead men don't bleed. And he's telling us he's an eyewitness to this account. And he that saw it, an eyewitness, bore record. But John knows that he needs to emphasize this, and so he gives us an exclamation mark. And he that saw it bore record. And his record is true. But he's still not satisfied. For the third time, he wants to tell you, I know that what I saw was unusual, but it was real. He that saw it bore record, and his record is true. And he knoweth that he saith true. For one purpose, God tells us in his holy word, so that you might believe. Because you see, God knew that one day there would be sophisticated intellectual people who would deny the reality of the death of Jesus Christ, who would try to say that Jesus simply slumped and fainted and swooned on the cross. And he really didn't die. And so God gave us every little bit of information that we need to know for a fact that Jesus died on the cross, so that our sins could be forgiven. That is God's gracious, wonderful, loving, and merciful plan to save sinners like you and like me. The value of the cross is infinite and difficult to describe with mere words. That is why the Cross Ministry has opted to produce this multimedia presentation of the crucifixion of Jesus. We hope that it has been successful in helping you to appreciate more fully the worth of the cross and to understand better what Jesus did to demonstrate his love for you and me, and what he did to glorify the Father in heaven. 2,000 years ago on Golgotha's Hill, no one appreciated or fully understood the significance of the event that was unfolding before them. Mary saw her son dying at the ruthless hands of the Roman soldiers, orchestrated by the people she had trusted and revered the most, the Levitical priests. The disciples saw their leader, the one who was to free them from Roman bondage, dying before their eyes as their dreams of freedom died with him. The crowd, who only a few days before had called him king, now mocked him and laughed at this joker who could not even save himself. The Roman soldiers saw nothing of more value to the event than the robe which Jesus wore. So they cast lots to see to whom the prize would go. The priests were satisfied that they could now get back to their lofty responsibility of guiding the spiritually blind and sacrificing the Passover lambs. Today, even on this side of Calvary, we are in danger of not appreciating the value of the cross fully. We often treat it as though it were a trinket, or at best, a religious relic. It is possible today to come to the cross and leave with nothing of more value than a souvenir robe. God forbid, may it never be. May we leave instead with the blood of Jesus Christ, our Passover lamb. Yes, there is victory at the cross, but only as it is seen from the empty tomb. And only the Christian sees the empty tomb. Jesus died to atone for our sins. He rose to give us life and victory. He is coming again to take us home. Hallelujah!